What's up? How are you guys? It's good to be back here. It really is. So grab your Bibles. Go to 1 Peter chapter 1. While you're turning, I just want to start with a story, personal experience. When I was in college, about a million years ago, in the mid-1970s, I went to a school called Nebraska Wesleyan University in Lincoln, Nebraska, across town from the Nebraska Cornhuskers, who used to have a good football team. Not anymore. It's interesting, while I was at Wesleyan, there was a large influx of Nigerian students. Wesleyan was expanding its borders, so to speak. These few people, by and large, had come from very rich families. Their fathers, many of whom were landowners, realized that their land was sitting on top of a whole bunch of oil. And so they began to tap into that literally and became quite wealthy overnight. And they came then to the United States to get educated. I have to tell you that the Nigerians, by and large, were the most unfriendly, nasty group of people I've almost ever known. They were surly. They were arrogant. They had muscle cars, every one of them, and they insisted on dragging their muscle cars up and down the little tiny street right outside my dormitory, and it was incredibly dangerous for them to do so, and as much as they were asked by security and everybody else not to do it, they kept doing it. Right across the hall from me was a young man whose name was Ogbonna. This was his real name, Ogbonna. And I tried to get acquainted with Ogbonna, but when I would pass him in the hall of our little dormitory, Burt Hall, and I would say hello to him, he would say nothing to me at all, completely ignore me. There were several times I stood in his doorway just to chat, try to chat with him, and I got nowhere. He would completely ignore me. And even though we as a Christian community there tried to reach out to them, we didn't get very far. My guess is that the Nigerians had a rough time there because of how incredibly different they were from us and that they were unwilling to rub shoulders with us. The culture clash there was something I think they found very difficult to get around, and we found it hard to try to bridge to them, and they probably have very little good to say about America and Americans because of our lack of relationship with them. Well, guess what? We live in a time of culture clash as well. Between the church possessing Christian values and the Word of God and the secular world. And I don't know if you guys are like me, but I'm seeing more and more of a divide there as time goes by. I noted with some real interest in our most recent presidential election and, you know, Senate and Congress and everything else, it was fascinating to me how there were commercials that would come on TV. And there would be, pardon me for using the expression, but there were liberals who would talk about the conservative politicians as holding to dangerous, extreme, radical views related to abortion and homosexuality and transgender. It was discouraging for me to see how now those who were in favor of a baby being able to live are considered extreme and dangerous. Certainly wasn't that way 50 years ago. And so, lest we think that we're not, you know, we're really in a very hostile community or environment, let me assure you, we are. You guys know that. You feel it. Even though there's not a ton of direct persecution, what we think of as direct persecution, there are nevertheless such marked cultural differences that it's hard. It's awkward for us. I can't tell you how many times my wife and I are sitting around drinking coffee early morning before we head off to our jobs. And we talk about this or that thing that's going on in the world, this or that sort of political thing that's happening or social thing that's happening. And how oftentimes we will say to one another, "Holy cow, our world is so messed up. And the next breath, I just wish Jesus would come back. I wonder if any of you guys feel that way. That's a rhetorical question. I don't expect you to embarrass yourself by actually asking or answering. It's interesting, as we come to 1 Peter, there is a group of people that Peter is writing to who are also experiencing culture wars. And we're going to talk about who these people are in just a second. The letter is written, we'll talk about it now, the letter is written to believers who, take a look at chapter 1, verse 1. Peter writes, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion. Almost certainly, these are Jewish believers. We'll set aside the word elect just for a second, but that word exiles is a really interesting term. In the first century, the Roman Empire had subdued new territories. They'd expanded their borders quite a bit. And what you did, if you're like that, and you expand your borders, you have to populate the region with Roman citizens. Otherwise, the indigenous people could rise again and be engaged in another revolt. It was not at all unusual for the Romans to go and actually force people to leave their homes, go to one of these regions, and establish a colony there. And if you had a different sort of a religion or a weird job, or you had your were of a peculiar ethnic background or whatever, then a lot of times you might actually be required to leave your home and relocate to one of these areas. When those people are in that category and they leave, the Romans called them by the word exiles here, the same word that we have in this passage. The Romans used in secular settings to describe these people who were deported and became forced colonists. And so Peter is writing to these exiles. The word exiles, by the way, would be legitimately translated by the English word refugees. People who are forced to leave their homes for whatever reasons and to relocate. Peter is writing to refugees. And what happens is that when a person would be forced to leave some urban center in Rome or the city of Rome itself and go elsewhere, when they settled there, the indigenous people normally didn't like them, would not allow them jobs, would not allow them to rise to some sort of prominence among the population. And so things became difficult for these colonists, refugees, as they had to relocate. And so what does Peter do? Peter writes to encourage them. He says, look, hang on to the hope of your salvation. And as you respond graciously to the hostile world, God will be glorified by your proper response. Now, when we come then to chapter 1, verses 3, 4, and 5, that's the historical background. That's the context here. We're going to summarize these three verses with this idea. We should always thank the Heavenly Father for the hope of eternal life which we have in Christ, and we'll be able to do this as we constantly note three truths. He's going to focus on three truths that will help us always thank the Lord for what we have in Christ. So three truths. I have hope because of the means of my salvation. I have hope because of the results of my salvation. That's verse 4. Verse 3 is, I have hope because of the means of my salvation, the hope of my salvation. Verse 5, I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. So that's where we're going in our verses today. By the way, let me just sort of set up the geography of where he's writing. Notice again in verse 1, these are exiles or refugees of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. Where's that? I'm here to tell you it's not South America, just in case you wondered. Okay, so here's where that region is. I'm going to turn our auditorium into a map just for a second. Okay, and I think I've done this with this kind of thing with you guys before, but anyway. And I don't know what direction that is in real life. What is that in real life? Somebody just said west. I just heard east and south. So anyway, what we're going to do, given our little map room here, we're going to pretend like that's north, Okay? What we're going to do is we're going to say Israel would be back in the last couple of rows over here. And then we have the coast that goes north from Israel, and it curves like this. We're going to say that this is what the Romans actually called Asia. We would call it modern Turkey. Okay, so this is Turkey. You guys with me so far? If you're with me so far, just nod your head. And you're going, this isn't so much fun, Dr. B. That's okay. I just want you to know where Peter's writing. The region that he's addressing here, Pontus, Cappadocia, Bithynia, Galatia, that's northern Turkey. What we would think of as northern Turkey, that's this area. The Apostle Paul had been to southern Turkey, but he hadn't gotten to northern. There was a very interesting thing that was happening. And here, you don't have to turn to this passage, but I want you just to listen. In Acts chapter 18 and verse 2, it talks about how one emperor, whose name was Claudius, who ruled from 41 to 54 AD, the emperor over all of Rome, kicked the Jewish people out of the city of Rome in 49 AD. It says that in Acts 18, 2. And he, Paul, when he came to Corinth, found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to leave Rome. The Jewish people were rioting in the streets of Rome. Jewish believers and Jewish unbelievers were rioting against each other over Jesus. And I just want to know, by way of application, when was the last time you started a fight for Jesus? That's what they were doing. That's intended to be funny. I missed. They were having fights. And so what does Claudius do? He says, look, if you're a Jew, he didn't distinguish between Jewish believers and Jewish unbelievers. He said, if you're a Jew, out of Rome. And so they all scattered. I think Peter's writing to the Jewish believers who left Rome and settled in Turkey. I think that's who he's addressing. All right? So that brings us up then to the first point of encouragement that Peter gives. We should always thank the Heavenly Father for the hope of eternal life which we have in Christ. And we'll be able to do this as we constantly note three truths. Here's the first one, verse 3. We have hope because of the means of our salvation, and we should bless the Lord or praise the Lord as a result. All right, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is, praise God. God ought to be praised. God, the Father of our Lord Jesus, according to his great mercy, that is because of his great mercy, his compassionate heart to alleviate spiritual suffering, he caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now notice, he uses an expression that we find in John chapter 3, that God causes us to be born again. Jesus has a very interesting encounter with the first Irishman ever mentioned in all the Bible, Nicodemus. Right? And remember what he says to Nick? He says, you got to be born again if you want to see the kingdom of heaven. Got to be born again. The Spirit blows where it wills and the Spirit gives birth. You have to be born again. A term similar to this is used there by Jesus. So Peter was there. Peter hears this as well. The idea of being born again is a figurative expression using birth to describe the new spiritual life that God has given to us in Christ. I want you to know here before I go on, and this is going to be in a super important theme throughout our section. Note the things that God does for us in this passage. Nobody gives birth to himself or herself. God does this for us and to us. If we start talking about you and your own physical birth and me and mine, you and I had nothing to do with that. How many of us had anything to do with our conception? I know you're kind of going, ew. That was mom and dad's work, right? How many of you had anything to do with your birth? None of us did. That was all something done to us by God. Our presence in a physical way on earth, our physical presence, cannot be undone by us. Even if you were to take your own life, somewhere in some drawer, in some municipality, there's a birth certificate that says you were here, and that cannot ever change. Let me just propose that when God gives birth to us and gives us spiritual life and causes us to be born again, that is not something we can undo. Now, about 15 years ago, let me just ask a question first. I want you to take a really good look at what I'm holding in my hand. You would call that a shoe. Very good. What kind of shoe is this? Now, I'm talking about, you know, the kind of the construction, the style of shoe, not the make and model. What kind of shoe is that? Does it have laces? There are no laces. This is called a loafer or a slip-on or something like that. About 15 years ago, I started wearing loafers. You know why? Because I couldn't keep my shoes tied. And I would double knot them and they would still come undone a couple of times during the day. It made me really upset. So I started to wear loafers so that my shoes wouldn't come untied. Now, I can't keep my shoe tied. My wife and I work together on our finances. Half the time we can't balance our checkbook with our ledger book with our bank statement. We have a hard time doing that. We almost always reconcile it, but sometimes we don't. But I, according to some, can frustrate what God has done for me. God has caused me to be born again. A lot of people think I have the capacity to remove that from myself, to lose my salvation, to be able to discard my eternal life. I'm thinking, wait a minute. You being born again wasn't your deal. It was God's. We can't keep our shoe tied. We can't balance our checkbook. And I'm going to suggest that we don't have the savvy to undo what God has done for us. And that's going to be a super strong theme all throughout this section. Something that would have been enormously encouraging for these refugees to know that they had a family somewhere that would be accepting of them. God is the Heavenly Father. And so, God ought to be praised and blessed for that. Why? Because it says He has caused us to be born again to a living hope. This is a confident expectation of what will happen in the future. Idea of hope, our idea of hope sometimes has a lot of doubt in it. You know, if I go buy a lottery ticket tomorrow, which I have never done, but if I were to go buy a lottery ticket tomorrow, I might hope that I'm going to win $147 trillion or something like that. Well, how likely is that? Not very. But this concept of hope, the concept of hope in the Bible, is not sort of shot full of doubt. This is a confident expectation. Hope is, in fact, saving faith oriented to the future. This is not a hope-so hope. This is a know-so hope. We know this is coming. And our hope is living. Now, in the ancient Greek world, Greco-Roman world at this time, there were all kinds of different ideas about the afterlife, kind of like what we have today. You know, people say today, well, you're reincarnated. Or when you die, you just become nothing. You become worm food, or, you know, you go to... You die, like Obi-Wan Kenobi, you die and go home to be with the Force. You know, that's that kind of thing. All kinds of different opinions about what happens when you die. The Greeks were like that too. They believe in some sort of a disembodied existence after death, but it wasn't really sure, and there was all kinds of wide opinion about what would happen and what it would look like. But whatever it was, according to N.T. Wright, whatever their view, he says some kind of life might come after death, but it was unlikely to be as rich and satisfying as the present one could be. I'm here to tell you, in our atheistic, materialistic culture, and by materialistic I mean we're only concerned with and we only believe in what we can see, material things, In our materialistic, atheistic culture, there's no hope. Bertrand Russell, a British philosopher and historian who died in 1970, and so now he knows better. In 1925, he wrote an essay entitled, What I Believe. And he wrote, I believe that when I die, I shall rot, and nothing of my ego will survive. I am not young, and I love life, but I reject the terror many feel at the thought of my own annihilation. I'm thinking, really? A thoughtful person will look at the prospect of that and feel terror. And so in so much of our own present culture, there's not much hope, not much hope. But I want you to notice, guys, that God has given birth to us. And the result is that we have a hope that is alive. It is living precisely because, as Peter says, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Now, a little theology lesson here. Most of us are going to be thinking that when we start to talk about the basis of our salvation, it's hung on the death of Jesus. As Jesus died on the cross, he said, "It is finished." So in what sense does the resurrection affect our being born again? What's the connection there? Three things show the connection. Number one, the Bible says that when we trust Christ as Savior, we are united with Him. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 30, 1 Corinthians 1:30, it says, and because of Him, because of God, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But there's a sense in which when we trust Christ as Savior, God incorporates us into Jesus. We are united with Him. It's not just that God, when we trust Christ and get saved, it's not just that God gives us a bunch of stuff like redemption and justification and sanctification. He does. But the greatest thing is that when we trust Christ as Savior, God gives us Jesus. And we are united with Him. And so the blessings that He has become ours as well. It's the first thing. Second thing is, the Bible says Jesus rose from the dead. And it's just all over the place. Let me read one verse that really pertains to this. Romans 4:25. Jesus was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. There's the resurrection of Jesus stated as a fact and as the basis of our salvation. Here's the third thing. The Bible says we're united with Christ. The Bible says Jesus rose from the dead. Third thing, the Bible says we will rise from the dead because we are united with Him. In John chapter 11, verse 25, 26, Jesus says to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And everyone who believes and lives, shall never die, because he's the resurrection. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21 to 23. 1 Corinthians 15, 21-23. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. That is, everybody in Christ will be made alive. But each in his own order, the Christ the first fruits, then it is coming those who belong to Christ. Finally, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. Ephesians 2, 5 and 6. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ. Notice the union in Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with Him, and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. All right, so here's the thing. In Ephesians chapter 2, it says that we've been raised up with Christ. Christ has been raised. We've been raised with Him because of our union with Him. In God's mind, we are so united to Jesus that where Jesus is, there we are also. In God's mind, it says we're seated with him in the heavenly places, which is really weird, isn't it? Doesn't it feel like you're sitting in a padded chair inside the worship center of Harvest Bible Chapel in Crystal Lake, Illinois? And surely you are. And up there with him. If Jesus rises from the dead, so will we, because we are in him. And that guarantees eternal life. If he rises from the dead, if he comes back to life, if he arises and we're in him, so do we. Because we have a risen Savior, we'll be resurrected as well. It's the resurrection of Jesus that also contributes to our new life. God uses all of that for us to be born again spiritually. Now, that's pretty serious stuff for a Sunday morning, isn't it? But there it is. That's the connection. Here's the second thing. The second truth that as we keep this in mind, we'll be praising God a lot. And that is that I have hope because of the results of my salvation, and therefore I should praise the Lord. Paul goes on to say that not only do we have this living hope, we also have an inheritance. It's imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you. In the Old Testament, the land of Israel was the inheritance God had for them, for the Jewish people. In the New Testament, we have an inheritance called the kingdom of God and or eternal life. In 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50, it says, I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Matthew 19, 29, everyone who has left houses or brothers, sisters or fathers, mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive a hundredfold and will inherit eternal life. Guys, there is something future for us that our living hope points us toward and gives us confidence in. And that is a future inheritance which consists of an eternal life, something that we will enjoy with God forever and ever. And that's described here as that which is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. Imperishable means it's not subject to corruption or death. It's undefiled means it's completely free of any moral impurity. It is untainted by sin. It is unfading, means it's not capable of losing its wonderful, pristine nature. It is untouched by death, undefiled, completely free of evil, and unimpaired by time. That became really important to me this last week. My wife and I were at Menards. We went to the shop for some stuff. And by the way, I have a really cool car. I'm just going to tell you, it's not an Aston Martin, I wish. I have a 2017 Ford Mustang that I bought before I ever came to Harvest Bible Chapel with Moody money. I didn't use Harvest money. I want to make that very clear. And I like my car a lot. It's cool. The good news is it's a Mustang. Bad news is it's only got four cylinders. Anyway, we're leaving Menards, and I was looking around, and I backed into a woman's car. Now, I'd like to say it wasn't my fault. She was sticking all the way out. She was in the road, and I looked this way, and I looked that way. I didn't see her. She's right behind me in the middle of the little aisle road thing, and I backed into her. And I got out of the car. I got out of the car. I said, look, hang on a second, I'm going to park my car, I'm not leaving, I'm going to be right back, we'll talk about everything. She got out of the car, looked at her car and said, you can go, it's no big deal, you were so nice. That's what she said to me. So it just goes to show that it pays to be nice, I guess, you know. And so I did, I left. I was willing to settle up and do whatever we had to do, but she said, now get out of here, it's perfectly okay. So much for wanting to keep my 2017 Mustang pristine. I now have a biff on it about this big on my right, left quarter panel and a scratch about that long. Our eternal life, our eternal, unfading, imperishable destiny won't ever get scratches on it. It'll never rust. It'll be made new all the time. It never wears out. And the best thing is, it's not mixed or tainted with moral evil. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. Revelation 21, 27, referring to the heavenly city, New Jerusalem, the eternal state. But nothing unclean will ever enter it, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Revelation 22 and verse 3, no longer will there be anything accursed in this eternal state, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. Guys, there is a future for us where it's not funky in the things that are believed. We won't have things crammed down our throats that we look at biblically and go, this is wrong. It can't be this way. This will ruin our society. What will happen to me and to my grandchildren if we continue to live in a setting like this? None of that will be the case. We are refugees. But we have a glorious future ahead of us with a home that's pure and beautiful and pristine. And we got to just hang on and wait. Notice it's kept in heaven for you. That is beyond all the mess of this life. It's up there. It's kept for us. God guards it. It's God who is guarding this. Third truth we need to keep in mind that will lead us to praise the Lord. It's I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. And that leads us to bless the Lord and praise the Lord too. At the end of verse 5, it says that this inheritance is imperishable, is reserved in heaven for you. And then he describes you, us, in verse 5, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Oh, man, there's all kinds of interesting theology here. Notice, we are guarded through faith. The word guarded means to be posted as a sentinel, to be a security guard. And even more precisely, is to take a group of soldiers and have them function as a security detail. That's this word. And notice that God is our security guard, and he is guarding us. How's he doing it? Through faith. By his power, through faith. Now, I want you to notice here that God guards us and keeps us in saving faith. He does this. By his power, he guards us in salvation through our faith. Now, we have a tendency to think, not wrongly, by the way, that when we come to Christ, we have faith in Christ. We exercise faith in Christ, and surely that's the case. Acts 16:31, the Philippian jailer says to Paul, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What does Paul say? Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. And if your household believes, they'll be saved as well. Got to believe. And so we have the capacity and the responsibility to believe. But we need to understand that there's something that happens before we believe, and that is that God works in us, empowers us, gives us the capacity and the inclination to actually believe. He gives us that. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. What's a gift of God? For by grace, saved, and faith is a gift of God also. So God gives us the ability to believe, and he by his power keeps us believing. And I think that's really important for us. As we see our culture become more and more aligned against us, as we are becoming forced more and more to have to surrender our Christian convictions, we have to keep in mind that even though we are fearful, not of the test, if we become fearful of abandoning Christ, if we cave into those pressures, God won't let that happen. Those of you who are public school teachers right now, I have my son and my daughter-in-law are both public school teachers. I don't know how they're going to get by when they are ordered to promote homosexuality and transgenderism in the classroom. I don't know how they're going to get by. We've never had that discussion with them. But all I can say is that if we feel the pressure to cave, we won't, because God promises to keep us. He'll preserve us. Now, there's a whole wing of Christianity that emphasizes, as we've talked about already, that it all depends on us, that I have free will, that I can actually frustrate the plans and the purposes of God, that I can go about choosing him or rejecting him, and I'm free and powerful to do that, that my will has that kind of capacity. The thing is, as you look through this passage and you ask that question, do we actually have that ability? This passage says no over and over again. In the same way that we cannot undo our physical birth, we can't undo our spiritual birth either, because we are kept by the power of God in the faith that we have. It's an amazing thing. What is it we're kept for and guarded for? It says at the end of verse 5, for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Our salvation is something we possess now, but the full realization of that is climaxed in the future when Jesus comes back to earth for us. And it's ready now, because it's all dependent upon the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the ascension of Jesus. And that's been ready for 2,000 years. And so this full revealing of the full salvation of everything God has in store for us, this inheritance that's imperishable, undefiled, unfading, this living hope, it's ready to come, and we better be ready for it. All right. Three things I want to suggest by way of application here. Number one, we got to remember that when we encounter hardships, like COVID, when we see the pressures being put upon us, when we are considering the fact, am I going to be able to hold on to my faith? The answer is yes. We have a permanent home. We are, in a very real sense, refugees right now on our way to our true home. And we need to hope in that. We can hope in that. Secondly, if you are nervous about the security of your salvation, if you doubt it, if you're concerned about maybe you've lost it or you might lose it, come back to this passage. Spend some time in it. Pray through it. Commit it to memory if you need to. Pay attention to what God says he's doing on our behalf. Final thing is, I just want to suggest is that maybe a couple of times this week, come back to this passage as well. Think through it. Make a list of three things that you are most looking forward to as it relates to your eternal, unfading salvation. Is it the possibility of being reunited with loved ones? Is it freedom from disease that you're carrying right now, or your loved one is? Is it freedom from financial and material worries? Make a list of the things that you are most looking forward to, and then take time just to thank God for the promise that we have that our future life with him is pristine and beautiful. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just want to ask, that you would keep us from becoming discouraged or fearful as it relates to our future prospects. We might have a tendency to think that because our candidate wasn't elected president, that hell is going to come to earth now. Pretty sure that's not the case. Pretty sure that you're still sovereign, even over presidential elections. And I'm pretty sure, Father, that you're not going to let us go. That when we're tempted to cave, you got to help us not to. And to be willing to suffer. But to do so in a way that will bring honor to your name. Father, help us to remember these things. I think they'll steady us when life gets crazy. And we'll thank you as you do. In Jesus' name, I pray.